I was hanging out with one of my friends from a different universe, but now I need to go back to my PC to play a game that he was talking about. Now, according to this guy, he said that the game's like really short. It's a short game, that it's very basic, but also very fun. Sounds like a load of rubbish. I know.
The game went on to spawn two other sequels, with the third one having a game-breaking glitch that the creator can't fix, so I can't complete the game! The game starts with a very basic first round of levels, teaching you the game. It's very easy, but it does teach you how to play. Some people may suck at the game.
How do you get past this? I died.
But I'm actually the best player ever, better than any other player of any game ever. I'm the best video game player ever, that's what I'm known for. Anyway, the final levels basically shove everything at you, with the final level being a level that gives you 50 seconds to complete, which I guess defeats the point of the title of the game being you have 10 seconds because you really have 50 seconds. Like, seriously game, be consistent. Oh my god, look, what the hell? This level is really challenging, considering my multiverse friend sucked at it.
How did I- No, I just failed at the easiest jump in the whole game.
Yeah, he's dumb. Anyway, after completing this level, nothing happens. You just go back to the title screen. That's it. That's the whole game. Did you expect more?
I met this man. I can't remember his name, but he showed me the multiverse. Yes, I know. It exists. This is crazy. This is bonkers. But after finding out about this, I would like to see how the multiverse existed throughout history and how it works. Then I'll explore the multiverse for my enjoyment, of course.
Do you think we'll be safe here? We'll be safe from those robbers, that's all I know. Actually, I thought of an idea.
Okay, where the hell am I? Why is everything white? Why does everything look so weird?
Oh my god, is that really you?
Who the hell are you? And why are you animated?
How do I explain this? You're in an alternate universe.
Yeah, I know that. I used the first episode machine.
Right, yeah, the first episode machine. That's the stupid way of traveling through universes.
What? Then what's the good way to travel through universes?
Easy. Use the big portal thing at the Death Core.
The Death Core? Like, the Death Star from Star Wars?
Oh my god, is that Chalek? Yeah, it is.
Hey.
Hey gamers, it's me. I'm here to go get this stupid Wii game. How would you like my Chalek impression?
Whoa, that was good.
Can you hurry up?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, it doesn't work. You're gonna have to relive again. Oh, for God's sake.
Well, I've had fun here. I'm gonna travel to a different universe now. Bye.
Why did my clothes change?
This film was made before Pixar was even called Pixar. This was back when it was called the Graphics Group, which was a division of Lucasfilm. You know, the Star Wars people. John Lasseter was actually the one who animated it, and it was his first computer animated thing that he'd ever done with Lucasfilm. Because of the success surrounding John and his animation, he became an important executive at Pixar, which gave him the power to do some very bad things. But let's not get into that. The short starts with a shot of just some trees. A mix of what looks like 2D art and 3D art. Kinda cool, I guess. Anyway, a weird looking creature that goes by the name of Andre is sitting. Yeah, he's just sitting, chilling. Suddenly a bee comes up to him. Oh no, what will he do? It's a bee. Bees are scary, you know. They stare at each other. So then Andre distracts Wally, who is the bee, by the way. He distracts him as he runs off really quickly, as if it was a Looney Tunes cartoon. Wally gets very angry, and rightfully so. Andre just ran off. He was about to sting him.
So the adventures of Andre and Wally B was truly groundbreaking. But that makes sense, considering almost anything that Pixar makes is truly groundbreaking. Except for The Good Dinosaur, that's just The Lion King. Hey gamers, it's me. I've played Super Mario Brothers and the real sequel, Super Mario Brothers Special. But did you know that there's another sequel to that first game? It's kind of like the second two, if you know what I mean. Yeah, I played another Mario.
Jesus Christ, Charlie. How can you get yourself to play almost the same game twice?
It's not the same game. One was made for the PC, the other one was made for the Famicom Disk System.
They're basically the same thing.
No, they aren't. This game is completely different from Super Mario Bros. Special. It is a completely different game.
This game marked the first game where Takashi Tezuka took over as director, as Shigeru was too busy working on The Legend of Zelda. The game is hard, as described by Tezuka, who said that Japanese players had mastered the original game, so they needed a more challenging sequel. So I, being the Mario Master, decided to play this game.
Are you insane?
Mentally? Yes. Physically? No. This game is too hard. Why is this game so hard? Who decided that this game should be this hard? What is wrong with that person?
You have to beat this game 8 times. Why? Why do you have to beat this game 8 times? I only want to play Mario game once. If I wanted to play Mario game multiple times, I would play a game multiple times. This game is the bane of my existence. I've never completed this game, but today is the day I'm going to beat this stupid game.
Why are you going to play this game? What's the point? I understand playing it once, but 8 more times? That's going to be almost impossible.
Yeah, I know. I'm the same. You don't have to tell me.
I didn't play this game 8 times. That's impossible! One playthrough took me 56 minutes, and that was using the rewind feature and warp zones. I cheated, and I still took almost an hour. This game is incredibly hard. This game introduced something to Mario that is quite possibly the best addition that was ever to exist, with that being the really bouncy trampolines. I don't know if that's the official name, but they're cool. You can use this to jump over the flagpole. I wonder what's behind the flagpole. Oh, a warp zone. To World 1. Or a death pit. What?
So you had to start again?
Did you forget about the rewind feature?
Now, the final boss. Bowser. No wait, that's his brother. And that's not the final boss.
So that's the game. Now we can go on to Super Mario Land, correct? Oh god. Hey gamers, it's me. After talking about Pixar's first thing, I got an itch. Not just a regular itch, a musical itch.
The trumpet plays the part of the melody line in the song on top of the guitar parts, which is also the melody. One guitar is providing the harmony. Yeah, that's right, I know music stuff. How little do you think of me? Taunt is one of the best songs on this EP, which is called Are You Alright, by the way. The cover has an anvil that fell on a cat, which references another song. One Day starts with multiple guitars, drums, and a trumpet. Suddenly the main singer sings the word stop, which makes the rhythm stop. The rhythm is very straight in this piece. The trumpet is honestly the best part. Like, who invented the trumpet? It's epic and cool. That's what I think anyway. This is a song about the cat. The singer sings about how someone had to kill his cat. Now, this guy may actually be going insane and talks to an anvil. Honestly, this wouldn't surprise me. Next, he's gonna be talking to a blue sheep he called Friend. Sorry. That was rude. There's an actual bridge part that builds you up to the final chorus, and it's amazing. The connection between the bridge and the chorus just shows the ingenious of the singer, Mr. Joy. Mr. Joy, you've done well. This song is amazing. I can't think of anything better. Better than Aussie Jingle Bells. This song is the best song in the EP. No doubt about it. I just can't stop listening to it. It's incredible. I love it so much. This song makes me want to jump up and down at a concert. It's that good. Thank you for blessing my ears. Love, Joy.
Well, that's it. That's the EP. Wait, Mr. Joy's name is Wilbur? Wilbur Soot? Hey gamers, it's me, Naplan. It's a weird concept. What's the point of it? Honestly, I don't think a single human being knows. If you don't know what it is, it's an Australian test that all years 3, 5, 7, and 9 have to do. And it's a bloody waste of time.
The National Assessment Program Literacy and Numeracy is a series of tests that are focused on specific areas. Normally, there's a test on maths, one on grammar, one on comprehension, and one on writing. There's actually two on maths, with one with a calculator and one without, but they are done like at the same time, like you do one and then the other in like the same block. The maths tests are always the easiest. I swear they are. The maths tests are the ones that you don't need to worry about. Then again, you don't need to worry about any of it, because Naplan is such a useless waste of time. The question will be, what is a better title for this story? Which is a stupid question, because that is up to opinion. Like, what type of question is that? That's the dumbest question I've ever heard in the entire universe. I hate you, Naplan. It's all your fault, Julia.
Hey gamers, it's me. I'm currently looking back at some of the movies that I've watched, thinking about all the movies that built me up to where I am now. Sometimes I think about the Stark, how he came out as Iron Man to the public. how he really likes Burger King, and how his best friend looks a bit different in this movie compared to the other movies.
The original idea behind this movie was to set it in a pre-existing Marvel universe, along with the X-Men movies, Spider-Man movies, and other Marvel properties, as shown by the original end credits scene of the movie. This idea can be seen throughout the early stages of the MCU, with the Weapons Plus program in The Incredible Hulk, and Marvel wanting Hugh Jackman to make a cameo in Captain America: The First Avenger. Obviously, the Weapons Plus program went on to be the basis behind the Falcon and the Winter Soldier Disney Plus show, but it probably was only in The Incredible Hulk to connect to a wider Marvel universe. This is when the movie makes the most dated reference you can possibly think of, with Stark telling the soldiers not to put that picture on their MySpace.
Nobody uses MySpace anymore.
We found out he met in 1999, and they build the original Iron Man suit.
The first one, Mark 1, Mark I, the stupid grey suit.
And look who it is, Rhodey! They go back home, and after Tony finds out his weapons are being used for harm, he shuts down his weapons. But he gets Burger King first. He has to get Burger King first.
Look, it's Coulson from the TV show where he dies over and over again and Nick Fury shows up 2 times.
He works for S.H.I.E.L.D. You guys know what S.H.I.E.L.D. is. It's S.H.I.E.L.D. It shows up in almost every single Marvel movie. Mentioned in Agent Carter indirectly, the main focus of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and the logo for the Coulson Academy, a school named after him at the end of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is in Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
And that's Iron Man. And I've got something to say to you. I am Charlie. Look, I know I said there's always other choices, but I didn't mean that I would play an NFL football game released in 2007. I guess the game on the shelf has disappeared again. You know what always sucks when this happens? It's disappeared before and I didn't know where it went. It literally just disappeared. Random noises started coming out of it. I don't know what it means, I don't know what it does. It's just random, weird noises that I do not understand. Oh look, there it is. Hey gamers, it's me. Before I go discover the sequel of Super Mario Brothers, I want to talk about second episodes of shows.
Normally, second episodes follow up from the pilot episode, yet sometimes they follow up from the first episode. In the Amazing World of Gumball's case, the pilot wasn't made to be the first episode, but to be a pilot episode, whereas Marvel's Most Wanted, the pilot was made to be the first episode. Safe to say it didn't work, because the show doesn't exist. I wonder what would have happened if it did come out.
At least it's not another Birds of Prey show.
I like the first episode, but the second episode opening with that jazz version of the Star Spangled Man is a bop.
So some of you may know this, the first episode machine. Marvel used it to create the first episode of Marvel's Inhumans. But have you heard of the second episode machine? The second episode machine is a knockoff Wii U Pro controller in the style of an SNES controller. The second episode machine is experimental, considering it's wireless and stuff, as opposed to the first episode machine, which had that massive wire that doesn't actually do anything. I want to be the first person to ever use this machine. It's going to be me, good old me. Except I'm not the first person to ever use this machine. It was Marvel to come up with the second episode of Marvel's Inhumans, of course. I'm so dumb, aren't I? Okay, 3, 2, 1. And that's where it started.
What do you mean?
I discovered another sequel, the American sequel, Super Mario USA.
You've got to be kidding me.
Yeah, I know. It's another one. It's ridiculous. It's not even a real Mario game.
That is ridiculous. Just don't play it.
I will. I have to. I have the urge to. Just like how I had the urge to play Banjo-Kazooie.
Do I need to remind you? There's always other options.
Yeah, I know. I know. But this one I have to play. I have to.
Just talk about pilots again.
No! Do I have to play this thing? I hate this game. This game sucks. I've always hated this game. I always have. For a while, I couldn't work out why I hated this game so much. I found out why. There's a very good reason as to why I hated it.
It's Doki Doki Panic, not Mario. I don't understand why this game sucks. I would just like regular Mario, but yet we are stuck with this plant-throwing game. I don't understand why they had to make this game. I don't understand why this game's so bad. Doki Doki Panic, not Mario. I don't understand why this game sucks. I would just like regular Mario, but yet we are stuck with this plant-throwing game. I don't understand that stupid big frog at the end. I don't really get why this game's a dream, I don't know.
Shut up.
What?
Just shut up. Play the game.
It's so nice to finally meet you again, second episode machine.
Look at yourself. You have a cord. You suck.
I may have a cord, but at least I didn't make Marvel's Inhumans episode 2.
I never thought I'd see the day when two fully grown controllers from two unsuccessful Nintendo consoles would fight each other. Can I continue talking about Super Mario Bros. 2?
Yeah, I don't care.
Me either, Charlie.
Whoa!
And that's for talking about Super Mario Bros. 2.
You said I could! I think I'm paralyzed.
I mean, you'd think so. We have been sitting in the same location for 5 hours.
I have a song that I sing to myself when I'm alone. Or stuck somewhere. Wanna hear it?
No.
Fine. What are we gonna do anyway?
Are there any vegetables around?
Hey, look! We could throw this at the second episode machine. Like in Super Mario Bros. 2.
Yeah, that'd work probably.
Take this!
How dare you! I'm the second episode machine. And I made the second episode of my...
Thank God that's over. I don't need you anymore, do I, first episode machine?
What?
Hey gamers, it's me. I'm currently standing in a field of Lego. Pretty cool, isn't it? I defeated the evil second episode machine, and now I'm here. You know, honestly, I don't even know what's going on half the time in my life. But at least I have Avatar here to make me feel happy. I mean sad, I hate this game! Well, that sucks. I don't understand how or what's going on, but my least favorite game has just turned into Lego. I didn't know that was possible. Whatever. Well, at least I still have Madden 08. Just gonna put it there, I guess. Yeah, whatever. Oh, what the hell? This must be some sort of disease. Everything I touch turns into Lego. Can there please just be something I touch that doesn't turn into Lego? Of course this doesn't turn into Lego. I guess the universe really does want to tell me that there's no other options. What happens to those episodes anyway?
They get uploaded to YouTube.
Right. How can I see them?
We'll have to travel through the multiverse, I guess. Oh, what the hell?
Yeah, that's the other thing that's been happening.
That's weird. I think it must be a multiverse event, because it's been happening to other people all over the multiverse.
Oh, thank God I'm not alone then. Hey gamers, it's me. After my least favorite game turned to Lego, I decided to do something. I went to the cinemas and watched the latest Marvel Cinematic Universe movie, Black Widow. You might be thinking, Charlie, didn't you just talk about Iron Man? Why are you talking about Phase 4? Well, shut up.
At the presentation, the host, Kevin Feige, left the movie to be announced last, for a release date of May 1st, 2020. Now, due to a certain water allergy going around, the movie got delayed to November 6th, 2020. But of course, due to progeria continuing to spread around the globe, the movie got delayed again to May 7th, 2021. Sadly, Disney wasn't too comfortable with releasing the movie in May, so they delayed it again to July 9th, 2021. Now, although Black Widow released in 2021, the movie was going to come out a lot earlier. Around the beginning of 2004, my birth year, Lionsgate managed to get the film rights up for Black Widow. And then they went on to announce 2 months later that they were going to make a Black Widow movie with David Hayter, known for being a voice actor in the video game series Metal Gear, and writing the screenplay for the movie version of X-Men. He was going to be the writer and director of the film, with Avi Arad, known for ruining Spider-Man, producing the movie. While developing Iron Man 2, Marvel had entered early talks with Emily Blunt to play Black Widow in said film, but she was unable to take the role as she had a previous commitment to star in the 2010 movie Gulliver's Travels.
Why would you want to be in Gulliver's Travels? That movie sucks! It's just about being really big and there being little people.
Obviously, we did not get Emily Blunt, we instead got Scarlett Johansson to play Black Widow. According to Kevin Feige in 2010, a meeting with Johansson had already taken place regarding a Black Widow solo film, but at the time, Marvel's focus was the Avengers, not on Black Widow. So yes, they were more worried about killing Phil Coulson than making a Black Widow film. Natasha ends up hitting her head on a table to make it possible to hit Dracov, as they all lived happily ever after. Well, not exactly. Natasha and Yelena end up freeing the Red Room girls, and they get saved, but Natasha has to fight Taskmaster one more time while falling from an exploding Red Room. They eventually hit the ground, just, and they make Taskmaster free. Now they can all live happily ever after. Correct? Wrong. Natasha dies. You'd know this if you watched Avengers Endgame. In that movie, during the 2014 time heist, her and Hawkeye go to get the Soul Stone. And if you know anything about the Soul Stone, then you know that the way to get it is sacrificing someone you love. So of course, Hawkeye and Natasha fought to see who would kill themselves first. Now, of course, you know Val from Falcon and Winter Soldier, correct? Well, here she is, with Yelena, who is mourning over Natasha's death. And Val decides to try and get Yelena to fight Hawkeye, as he is apparently responsible for Natasha's death. I mean, if you're gonna blame anyone, blame that stupid rat for bringing Scott Lang back to end up coming up with the idea for the time heist. I mean, seriously, come on, guys.
So that's Black Widow, the first movie in Phase 4 of the MCU, which is crazy. Hey, I wonder what the next movie's like. Well, that doesn't matter. I've got important business to attend to. I've got surgery in an hour. Hey gamers, it's me. I don't want to deal with any more bees. That's right, I've had enough of those pesky little things. I want something more special, something that can shine a light onto me, to make me feel special, in a way. I've got it! A lamp. That really made my day, and now it will make yours. Or my own. Because I'm talking to myself.
Lasseter took a sleeping bag to work and slept in the office under his desk so he could work on the short film early in the day. That's commitment to a 2-minute short film. Luxor gets annoyed by this, and then it ends. A much smaller story than the one about bees, that's for sure. Overall, the film was very fun and interesting. It's nothing to write home about, of course, but it's a fun and enjoyable 2 minutes of time. I really liked it.
So that's Luxor Jr. That's it. There's nothing else. Did you expect more? It's about a bloody lamp. I mean, come on, guys. Like, yeah, okay, the lamp shows up in other Pixar movies. We get it. But do I care? No, I couldn't care less. Now, can someone get me my damn coffee? Hey, gamers. It's me. Now, I know I said I wanted a coffee, but what I really meant is I wanted a can of drink. It's not that difficult to work out. At least that's what I thought to myself until I got an actual coffee. So instead, I had to walk out myself and ask the first episode machine to do it for me.
What will it be, fine sir?
Just a Pepsi, please. That's all I really want.
Ooh, you're one of those tough drinkers. I see, going for a straight Pepsi? Risky move. I wouldn't do that if I were you.
Let's just say this isn't my first rodeo. By the way, this better not turn into Lego.
Oh, don't worry, dude. It won't.
Good. So yeah, now I have a Pepsi. Hey gamers, it's me. Have you ever seen a musical before? Because I have.
Now this song goes on and on and on, but if I was to write a musical for myself, I know what I'd sing. Life is like a hurricane here in this universe. Machines, portal guns, teleporters, it's a blur of light. Might find my favorite game on a plain World Cup avatar. Woo! Every day it's on the shelf avatar. Woo! Tales of bum guys, I just want avatar. Woo! Seems they're heading for the final boss fight. Sitting in the corner crying, that's right. My worst traits become annoying avatar. Woo! Every day it's on the shelf avatar. Woo! Tales of bum guys, I just want avatar.
It's me. I'm not a fan of the way PlayStation 2 games are presented. Something about them just makes them feel so goddamn cheap.
Here, they're silver. It looks so good. What was that?
What the hell is going on? Hey gamers, it's me. Ever since this Platinum Hit curse, I've been very used to seeing silver everywhere. Now, do I want to face off against the PlayStation 2? Yeah, of course I do. And no, I'm not talking about the Nicolas Cage movie.
The song is on the album Asinine, but it's written really weirdly, like that Real Smasher guy putting a number in the name. Well, I mean, it makes sense. The song is made by Tech9, who are again, put a number in his name for literally no reason whatsoever. Sometimes I don't understand people. This piece has Tech9, Chris, Joey Cool, King Iso, and the Dwayne Johnson Rock himself. Now, had anyone actually heard of these people before this song came out? Well, I mean, you've probably heard of The Rock from Journey 2, but the other ones? No, of course you hadn't. How did this tech guy even get The Rock on the song? The Rock has this weird outro part where he clearly was just talking to the mixer who was mixing the song, and honestly, it's very awkward. You can even hear the sound of like his water bottle closing, which it's quite funny. In conclusion, the song is like a 6 out of 10. It's not something I actively want to listen to, but on occasion, I would like to hear the song. I'm not that much of a rap person, unlike an alternate version of myself, but I do like the occasional song.
Well, that's what The Rock sounds like when he raps. Kinda funny, if I'm gonna be honest. Time to figure out what this border is about. I think it has something to do with Nicolas Cage. Hey gamers, it's me. I watched The Incredible Hulk. That's right, the one with Edward in it. The Incredible Hulk happens to be the second Marvel Cinematic Universe film, following Iron Man, of course.
Sadly, Avi Arad had control over it. No, that has nothing to do with the production, it's just a sad reality that Mr. Ruined Spider-Man had some sort of control over the movie. Anyway, after 2006, Marvel Studios made some sort of deal with Universal to somewhat own the rights to the Hulk. The new Hulk movie was very similar to the Incredible Hulk TV series and had several shots that looked identical to the series. Marvel at first said that the first Hulk movie was similar to a comic book one shot in an alternate universe, but really it was just another Hulk movie, it's nothing special. The inspiration behind the Incredible Hulk was the comic book series Hulk Grey, which is a retelling of when the Hulk first appeared, which apparently shows the love story between Bruce Banner and Betty Ross. Apparently, the first draft of the first film was in 1996, and two scenes from that film were transferred into this film, the scene being Bruce jumping out of a helicopter, and the scene of Bruce trying to... well, you know. Yes, out of all the scenes, they were the ones they kept.
This is what I call the worst MCU movie. Now, that doesn't mean I hate it. Far from it, actually. I do like the film, actually. It's not the worst MCU thing ever. That award goes to Marvel's Inhumans. But it's just not good when you compare it to those other films. Well, that's The Incredible Hulk. Mamma mia, that was an incredible film, I guess? I don't know. Well, anyway, I'm still on the hunt for Nicolas Cage, so I'll tell you when I find him.
Chalek, only a few more now.
I'm so sick of talking.
I know, but I believe that you'll be able to push through.
Hey gamers, it's me. Ever since this border appeared a few days ago, I've had a long list of things for me to do. The first thing is to talk about Five Nights at Freddy's 2, then talk about Face Off, not the Nicolas Cage movie, and then The Incredible Hulk. I really have a great list of things I need to talk about. But first, we need to talk about Freddy Fazbear. Again.
Now, although I have no idea about the lore of this game, I can tell you that this game is in fact a prequel to the original game, which is quite strange, but then again, Indiana Jones did the same thing. The game is quite simple, with literally the exact same controls as the original, with the game being a click adventure game. Very simple.
Well, that's Five Nights at Freddy's 2. What a game, I guess. It's alright, it's a 6, 7 out of 10. Well, that game was terribly scary, wasn't it? Anyway, I think it's finally time to see what all the fuss about Avatar was really about. Hey gamers, it's me. I still haven't managed to get rid of this silver border. A quick recap for you lot is that this border appeared while I was talking about PlayStation 2 games. It's the silver border from the Platinum Hits cases, and it appeared all around me, which was weird. I've gotten used to it now. Anyway, I'm here to talk about the MCU movie, Iron Man 2.
Why are you starting with Iron Man 2?
Oh yeah, I should probably explain to you a lot why I'm starting with the second movie. I actually did start with the first movie several months ago. I talked about Iron Man. Obviously, because that's the first... What did you expect me to say? And I'm going through the entire MCU. Yes. That's including Marvel's Inhumans. Surely you could have worked that out when I talked about the Incredible Hulk.
Sometimes I just don't understand things. I'm not a genius, Charlie.
Oh, don't worry, Bomb. I just thought I should explain it to you.
Wait, I'm confused.
What now?
So you're telling me you talk to yourself like this normally?
Yeah, like once a week, every Saturday.
Yeah, he has a problem. Just go back to talking, Charlie. We're only meant to be an audience.
See? Thank you, Bomb. But I'm happy that you guys are my audience. Just imagine if there were other people seeing this.
Yeah. I can only imagine. Right? So he gives his entire company to Pepper Potts, and he goes to a racing track, and he plans to race? While all this is going on, Tony Stark has been in trouble with the government. He has to explain to the government that the Iron Man armor is not a weapon, and is in fact a suit of armor that can protect the world. Little does he know that he's talking to a Hydra agent. Whatever. Tony Stark makes the new element, puts it inside him, and now he can live again. He finds out about Hammer's big plan, and travels all the way to Stark Expo to see what was going on, because Justin was presenting there. Meanwhile, there's been this whole storyline about some birds and some robots, but basically Justin just used Ivan. Ivan then escapes, and uses the hammer tech to fight Iron Man and his new sidekick, War Machine. Black Widow and Happy try to find Ivan, but it is not successful. They end up winning the fight against Ivan, though, obviously. Tony is then brought into a S.H.I.E.L.D. meeting with Nick Fury, who tells him that Iron Man was good for the Avengers, but Tony Stark wasn't. He then makes Tony Stark a consultant, which then leads on to the Marvel one-shot, The Consultant. And the ending scene of The Incredible Hulk with Tony Stark shows up. The post-credit scene reveals that Phil Coulson has found a magical hammer that fell from the sky, and calls up S.H.I.E.L.D. to tell them all about it. You could probably guess what that hammer is.
Now, tune in next time when we talk about Thor from Asgard, and even more about Phil Coulson, the agent. Luckily, something wasn't as universally hated until Marvels and Humans. Well, except for Thor the Dark. No one cares about Thor the Dark World. Did you know that? No one cares about Thor the Dark World. If you like Thor the Dark World, I don't know what are you doing?
Hey gamers, it's me. Last year, Chalek talked about some Christmas carols, but there's some that he didn't mention. I wonder what my background color is, because, you know, Chalek is orange, the first episode machine is yellow, surely mine is a different color again. Ooh, mine is a bluish color. Very nice, big fan of that. Anyway, the first song I'm going to be talking about is a song created by George Michael known as Last Christmas. You may have heard a parody of this song earlier in the His Mario 123 Show episode 60, or the original parody entitled This Christmas that was meant to be a love letter for a certain someone, but he bailed out on giving her the love letter, which led to the song. Now this song, All I Want for Christmas Is You, is very annoying. You hear it so many times it's not funny, except for the fact that it is kind of funny. It's almost as overplayed as that Maroon 5 song Memories. Now that song is the worst song to ever come out. Of course, I'm just kidding about that. It isn't the worst song ever. That would go to Ground Zero by Real Smasher. Bye bye now!